In this video, I'll be replacing my old install of Linux with Slackware 1.1.1, released early December 93. If you saw my last episode on Linux, you know I'm getting quite sick of my old and increasingly broken install of SLS I made a year ago. With a brand new distribution and all updated software, everything that failed on SLS should hopefully just work this time. And there's a lot of speaking for it. By the end of 93, Slackware was the distribution to get. Nothing could really compete. But first, let's have a closer look at Slackware itself. Before Slackware, the big distribution that most people used was SLS. SLS was a fairly complete distribution including most software you'd want to run. However, it was maintained by one guy who mostly assembled it from pre-assembled binaries scavenged from the internet. As a result, there was a lot of bugs. Both scripting errors, and in regards to the system, with incorrect file system permissions and symlinks. During the beginning of 93, there were basically weekly bug fix updates for SLS. Despite being known as a buggy mess, it was the distribution that ruled. One of these users was Patrick Folkeding, who had installed it on a number of computers and helped others do the same. He had compiled a list of fixes to apply to any newly installed copy of SLS. These fixes often took as long to apply as installing SLS in the first place. He was eventually persuaded to release these fixes publicly, which is what Slackware originally was, a fixed version of SLS with some select enhancements. The distribution quickly grew, both in size and in popularity. By late 93, Slackware had pretty much taken over the crown from SLS. By version 1.1.1, released in early December 93, it was no longer intercompatible with SLS install disks. This is the version I'll be installing. My copy comes from Infomagic's Linux CD-ROM, the December 1993 edition, available on archive.org. As a reminder, here are the specs of the computer I'm using. I am also dual booting this, with MS-DOS 5 and Windows 3.1. Now, I imagine a lot of users installed Slackware from floppies back in the day. Slackware is a fairly huge distribution, spanning about 53 disks. There is, however, a better way. Ideally, I'd just install one disk and load the rest of the CD-ROM. However, I will need to recompile the kernel to change the I/O address for my CD-ROM interface before I can use it. But that means I only need to install the floppy disks required to recompile the kernel, and pull the rest of the distribution from CD-ROM. And on the CD-ROM, I can find all the tools I need to make the boot disk from MS-DOS straight off the CD-ROM. Beyond that, I only need 3 base disks to install a bootable system. As a side note, I'd also like to mention that by this point in late 93, Linux had more or less finished transitioning over to GNU's gzip for file compression. These are the files ending with gz. Before this, the traditional Unix compress utility was used, which ended with a large z. This was based on LZW, which was a patented algorithm. Gzip, aside from not having any patent issues, also provided better compression. But with the floppy disks written, it's time to reboot into the installer. After booting into the system, it's time to deal with the partition table. When I installed SLS a year ago, I opted for a 64 MB Linux partition and 16 MB of swap. When I made that choice, the file systems on offer was Minix and the first extended file system. The first extended file system was still under development and was a bit experimental, so I went with a Minix file system. The problem with the Minix file system is that the largest volume size is 64 MB. This time, I'm using the second extended file system, which doesn't have the size restriction. As I discovered on SLS, disk space is a concern. So I'm going with a single partition and no swap. I'll use a swap file instead, which should hopefully allow me to balance disk usage to swap needs. The partitioning concludes with me crossing my fingers that I didn't wipe the wrong partitions and reboot. Once back in on the boot disk, I can run the setup utility. The first question it asks is if I want to remap the keyboard layout. This wasn't a question I got when I installed SLS a year ago, as the keyboard layout was a compile time option for the kernel at that point. It has me exit a couple times as it complains about there not being a swap partition, and I fail to remember the correct answers to its questions. Anyway, after selecting that I'm installing from scratch and that I'm using ext2 as my file system, it wants me once again to confirm that I really want to install from scratch. After that, it proceeds to format. With a hard disk of this age, I opt for a slower format where it checks for bad sectors. I I am also asked if I want to access my MS-DOS partition from Linux, so I add it and continue. Since my CD-ROM drive won't work with the standard kernel, I proceed with a floppy install. As I only wrote the A-series base disks, that's all I select here. I can install more packages later. Before it starts installing, it asks me a final question. Do I want to be prompted about packages to install? I say yes. And from here, it starts installing the packages from the disks. The required packages are installed automatically without asking. And then we get to the kernel. Slackware has two generic kernels, one for IDE-based system and one with SCSI support. Both are marked as optional, so you'll have to pick the right one. This is all helpfully explained. The installation concludes with an opportunity to make a boot disk. Since I'm not going to configure LILO for my system, I'll want this. Finally, I get to configure a few symlinks and then the questions about the bootloader. With the final question being what my time zone is, I can finally reboot into my new system. As a long-time Linux user, I must say that the boot-up feels a lot more modern and familiar than SLS did. Like, there's an actual init system with run levels. Logging in, the shell also feels modern and familiar in a way. First order of business is to copy the kernel to my MS-DOS partition. That way, I should be able to boot without using the boot floppy. And a quick reboot later and this seems to work just fine. But now I need some more install disks. I only had 6 known good blank floppies at hand, so I'll reboot and write the application series. I technically don't need these to recompile the kernel, but they add a text editor, Joe, that I know how to drive. And if I'm going to modify any files in the kernel sources, I want a text editor that I know I can use. Writing disks is always a bit of a slog, but it went by uneventfully. Shortly, I had my text editor and I could proceed to writing the development series. And this too seemed to proceed uneventfully. Huh? I wonder what that's about. It doesn't seem to complain about anything going wrong, so I guess it's fine. With the development series installed, I should be able to recompile the kernel and get my CD-ROM drive working. This time, unlike on my SLS install, there are no patches to apply. Everything I need is already included in the kernel. So all I have to do now is to configure the features I want, and then change this one bit of configuration so that it looks for my CD-ROM drive in the right I/O port. However, when I get the sound configuration, I'm in for a surprise. The sound configuration is done by an executable compiled from C, but it seems like the linker isn't happy with libgcc. On further inspection, going back to the installation, it seems the libc package is corrupted. I check the ISO image I'm using, and it's corrupt in there too. I don't know if this is a bad dump on archive.org, or if all copies of these disks were bad. I noticed there was two versions of libgcc, one for shared libraries and one for static linking. So I tried sweeping the problem under the rug, and it seemed to work. So let's pretend that never happened and continue configuring the kernel. And this time, it seems to work just fine. So I answer the questions and end up with a configuration. Before starting the compile, I quickly hop into the header for the Mitsumi CD-ROM driver and change the I/O port. But I guess now it's time to start compiling this thing. And off it goes, chugging along without any incidents. About half an hour later, the compile concludes and I have a Z image. So I copy it over to my MS-DOS partition and reboot. And as you can see, both my sound card and the Mitsumi drive is detected. And this means I should now be ready to install the rest of the system. I just enter the setup utility like before, but selecting CD-ROM instead of floppy. I need to tell it what type of drive it is, as different drivers get different device nodes. At this point in time, device nodes are not created dynamically. They are literally a bunch of files on disk, created during installation. And then I have to tell it where on the disk the Slackware files are, as this varied depending on the CD-ROM distribution you got. And from here, I just select all the disk sets I'm interested in. And now, it just starts going through all the packages, except this time, I don't have to swap any disks. Everything is on the CD-ROM, and most of the time it's not even reading from the disk. Having just installed the base system and development tools from 14 floppy disks, watching it just read everything off the disk in a relatively snappy fashion, it really felt like the future. All of this took about 15 minutes to install, but I was just staring at it in amazement the entire time, enjoying not having to swap any disks. So with X11 installed, I just gotta configure this real quick. This was a fairly trivial task on SLS, so I didn't expect much trouble here. I took one of the examples and modded it for my chipset and... oh, I've forgotten to define a mode line. Well, that shouldn't be any problems. There are examples to copy. And now we're still not the next Windows? Dot clock expected? Never seen that one before. This one confused me. I tried the other example, but I couldn't get that working either. I copied over the xconfig from my old SLS install, and that has the same error. I broke character and looked at the source code, and this error is only emitted in one place. In the modeline parser, if what's following the name isn't a number, then this is the error you get. I don't understand it. Is there something wrong with the Slackware release I got? Is this just a bad dump, or is it all disks? I looked over in Usenet, but I can't see any unusual complaints about X11 not functioning. In a last-ditch attempt to get something on screen, I installed the VGA16 server. This is suboptimal to say the least, as it can only provide 640 by 480 resolution at 16 colors. The SVGA server would allow for 800 by 600 at 256 colors, and that's what I got on SLS. Anyway, with the VGA16 server, getting X Windows working was painless. But what I really wanted to do here was to give the CD player application, Workman, a go. This is one of the applications I failed to run on SLS, and Slackware came bundled with it. The application seems to launch just fine, and I'm able to press play. No sound though. I know why, however. By default, Linux mutes the CD audio input. I just got to get the mixer program compiled and unmute it. So I enter the directory for the XView-based mixer and I type make and... it's missing a library? At this point I'm almost out of disk space, so adding more libraries isn't really on the table. Guess I'll try the terminal version? Wait, what? It can't find ncurses? Didn't I install that? I can play the CD, but I can't find a way to unmute it? This is so stupid. Anyway, let's see if I can get the sound card playing some tunes. At least the mod player hasn't let me down before. Huh? It can't find soundcard.h? I tried copying it from the Linux source tree into the include directory, but now it's failing for other reasons. I can't help but feel that this thing hasn't been updated properly for the new sound API. And I'm a bit at a loss. I genuinely expected this to mostly just work, but somehow I ended up with a system less functional than what I started with. I mean, the bits that work are working really well, but there's just these brick wall issues that prevent me from doing what I want. And somehow I'm once again out of disk space. It makes me wonder, did I do something wrong? Am I missing something obvious? Did I just get a bad copy of Slackware? Let me know in the comments, is this really the 93 Slackware experience? Anyway, that concludes the 1993 season. I've only just started working on the 94 season, so it's gonna be a while before that's out. Feel free to subscribe so you don't miss it when I finally upload it. Until then, thank you all for watching.